Welcome to the Famous Graves Podcast. I am your host, Mike Knox. Wanted to start off by saying I'm a big advocate for epilepsy awareness. My daughter has epilepsy, and I just read that the LA County Sheriff's Department, I know in the Santa Clarita area, I don't know if it's all of LA County, but they are actually offering special assistance in an emergency, which I think is great. So basically you can register your child with special needs with the Sheriff's Department. And then it'll basically be put, that information will be in use. So, for example, what made me go, oh, this is a great idea, was that my daughter used to have seizures, and we would be going to the hospital at like 3 o'clock in the morning, going through, you know, because, first of all, 911 wouldn't take my call, they'd be busy, or they would say it's not an emergency, and they would hang up on me. And nothing ever happened to those 911 dispatchers at all. And so, you know, I'd be driving through like a red light, you get pulled over by the police. The police don't believe that your child's having a seizure because there's no ambulance there. To me, it was always just a matter of time. The longer that you have a seizure, the more, you know, damage to the brain that can happen. Also, my daughters were status seizures that did not stop on their own. They didn't need rescue medication. Then we would get to the hospital and it would be the same thing where we'd have to, you didn't come in through an ambulance, so you had then have to be processed in through the lobby, fill out all these forms. My child was having a seizure right in the lobby and they could care less. So it bypassed everything. And what we were doing for quite a long time was we would call ahead to the hospital, say, my daughter is having a seizure, call the hospital, then the hospital administrator would then get the emergency room prepared that a child is coming in who is having a life-threatening seizure. Didn't work all the time, but it was the only plan. Again, there are no laws in the state of California at all for epilepsy, so you can be discriminated against in every single way for having epilepsy. There's 3 billion people in the United States with epilepsy, 65 million worldwide. There are over 100,000 adults. There are 60,000 children in the state of California with no laws. I, again, have tried many times to... I've contacted over 500 lawmakers, had one lawmaker. I wrote a law for that lawmaker, and that lawmaker lost her position. She's trying to run again, but does not talk to me anymore. So I'm back to square one. But, you know, I'm not bitter at all. But anyways, hats off to the Santa Clarita Sheriff's Department. That is a fantastic policy that they're putting in place. And I got to tell you, I'm proud of you guys. Not so much with the LAPD, but LA County Sheriff's Department, you guys are doing good. Also, I was reading in the Epilepsy Advocate, there was an article about this guy. They don't give his last name, and I don't remember his last name, but his first name was Tim, and he was from San Antonio, Texas. And so I've reached out to this magazine quite a few times, and they've ignored me, like a lot of the other ones. But I just wanted to read this guy's life story because I found it interesting. Because so I talked to him when I went to Florida. I met him in Florida and talked, and so he was somebody that, you know, had been in the military and he was working for the government and never had a seizure his entire life till he was 24, and it totally, you know, derailed his entire life pretty much. Now he's back on track. It was just a very nice guy, and it was a heartfelt story, and he's just like I am, trying to get out there, spread the word, be an epilepsy advocate. And so I'll kind of touch on this article a little bit. But his main thing with the article is he has epilepsy, and my epilepsy journey has been long and filled with roadblocks. I was diagnosed in 1979 after having my first temporal lobe seizure when I was 24 years old and in the best shape of my life. Seizures made my life so difficult, I decided not to reenlist as a firefighter in the Air Force. Eventually, I had to turn in my driver's license, and I dealt with skeptical doctors, nurses, employers, and colleagues, including coworkers who would call me Spasmo, who didn't believe I had a serious medical issue. And that still goes on today because my coworkers are the exact same way. But my journey is also filled with perseverance, gratitude, and positivity. Things got a little better in 1998. That's when I had the vagus nerve stimulator, the VNS, implanted in my chest. Now when I feel a seizure coming on, I can swipe the magnet across the VNS as a way to stop the seizure. The VNS didn't eliminate my seizures, but it did slash my recovery time. Anti-epileptic drugs also, but I still experienced dozens of seizures every month. By 2004, I was desperate for a better quality of life. My only option was to have temporal lobe lobotomy. Instead of being afraid of the surgery, I was excited. I was tired of epilepsy, what epilepsy was doing to me. I will always remember waking up after my surgery. Sleeping in the chair next to me was my makes me cry. Just the fact that he was there, it was so moving. I've had only 8 complex partial seizures since 2004, the last one about 10 years ago. I still have auras pretty regularly, but they don't impact my life. One of my granddaughters has epilepsy. Another has non-epileptic seizures. I worry about them all the time, but both are blessed to have my same doctor. I know they are getting excellent care. Today, my life is full. I work in a psychiatrist's office. I cycle 10 to 25 miles a day along the river walk because there is no car traffic and it is well patrolled by park rangers. My wife of 47 years and I spend as much time as we can with our 2 children and 7 grandchildren. On rough days, it's encouraging to know my family is there doing everything they can to help. Being an advocate is very important to me. I always tell people, do your research and ask questions. Don't be afraid to get a second or third opinion. But this is what I want them to know about everything else. Never settle and never give up. Living well with epilepsy can be done, but you have to make the choice to do it. And again, great story. Tim is a great guy. I was very honored, talk about gratitude, to meet somebody like that. And I also met with him. You know, we spent the weekend at a convention together and then actually drove. He was the one guy there that we shared a car with to the airport with my family. So I have a TikTok, which the handle is Famous Graves, and I try to document Famous Graves. I go there, film the graves of famous people. Also, there are a lot of famous people that do not have graves or unmarked graves, and I also do a little tutorial on those. One guy, though, that just popped into my head the other day that he's still alive, but was a comedian named Yahoo Serious, and because there's not a lot of comedians that are out of Australia, and that is why, but he was like super hot in the 80s, and so I looked him up. And he's got a really fascinating background because, of course, in the 80s, you couldn't Google anything or look anything up. And so the history of him as a comedian I thought was interesting. And so I just wanted to talk about him a bit. Yahoo Serious, which at the time was like this hilarious name because it's 1988 and we don't have a lot going on in our lives. So Yahoo Serious was like, what? There's this crazy comedian guy from Australia? He was born Greg Gomez Pede in 1953. He's an Australian film actor, director, and composer. His films include Young Einstein, so that was his very first movie, Reckless Kelly, and Mr. Accident. He writes, directs, and produces, stars in, and composes the scores of his movies, which, if you ask me, that's the best way. When people ask me how to break into Hollywood, that is the best way. You shoot your movie, and Mr. Yahoo Serious there did it way back before an iPhone. You can do everything on your iPhone now. You can film it, you can edit it, you can compose it. Anything that you want is all there on your iPhone. So we need to have another Yahoo Serious out there. He was born in Cardiff, the city of Lake Macquarie in Hunter Region, New South Wales, Australia. He attended Glendale East Public High and Cardiff High School, then worked as a tire fitter. By the way, they spell tire fitter T-Y-R-E, to pay for his tuition at the National Art School in Sydney, but was expelled. It doesn't say what he was expelled for, but you know, those stories of getting expelled from art college, it's always good to pass it down to your grandkids. In 1988, he co-wrote, produced, directed, and played the title role in the movie Young Einstein. Einstein as a young apple farmer in Tasmania who derives the formula E equals MC squared. So I haven't seen that movie in a long time. I remember that I did go and see it, and as far as I remember, it was hilarious. He was a hilarious guy. Which made me stick in my head, whatever happened to that guy? In 1993, he released his next movie, which was called Reckless Kelly, a satire about modern descendants. In 2019, in a rare interview, I guess he wasn't doing any interviews, he stated that, I have been writing and I hope to continue to make more movies. So that was about 3 years ago, post-pandemic there, which curbed, kind of sidelined everybody making movies. But he got an honorary doctorate from the University of Newcastle in 1996 and was a guest celebrity for the opening of the 2000 Sydney Olympics, which is pretty cool, man. So 22 years ago, he was opening up in the Olympics. What I really found cool was that he got married, and So in 2000, he was evicted from, or 2020, he was evicted from his property in order to pay $15,000 in rent to his landlords. And he stated he was unable to pay because of the impact of COVID-19. You know, they're saying, you know, we can't substantiate if that's real or not. I got to tell you, if you haven't worked since your last film, and you're, say you're hustling, trying to go on the, say you're going on a road as a comic, you're not making a lot of money. There's, and then COVID hits, where there were a lot of comedians that I knew that moved home, or they moved out of state because LA was too expensive. I don't know what the comedy scene is in Australia, but I don't think it's the same as Los Angeles or New York or Boston, for that matter. But I can totally see where COVID just devastated him and everybody else, for that matter. And here we are, supposed to be 2 years. You know, we were on lockdown for 2 years. What do you expect from everybody? It's like the letter that I get from the electric company, which is like five times more than I've ever spent before. And they're like, oh, yes, you have not used, you've used way too much electricity in the last couple months. Yeah, because I've been at home the entire time, because everybody's working from home because of COVID-19. It doesn't say anything that. It just talks about what a horrible human being I am for using too much electricity at my home when I'm stuck there 24 hours a day. So I'm on your side on that one, Mr. Yahoo Serious. So what I found fascinating was that he sued Yahoo.com, which, for you kids out there, it was before Google, and Yahoo was basically, you know, it had a stock price, and everybody was ranting and raving about how great Yahoo.com was. And it was supposed to be, and then Google came along and devastated it, and there is no, I don't even think anybody uses Google anymore. I should probably check and see if it's still around or not. But anyways, that was in 22 years ago. He sued the search engine Yahoo for trademark infringement, and the case was thrown out because he could not prove that he was selling products or services under the name Yahoo, therefore could not prove that he suffered any harm or confusion due to the search engine. So I'm thinking that's a bit of a gray area there. So what if he had t-shirts and mugs? Then he could have been, you know, have the trademark for it. But again, that shows how hard it is. Everybody is always talking about, well, just sue them, and how hard it is and how much time and money it takes. And even then, you've got to get an attorney. This is the thing. If you're in a car accident and you have like a serious injury to you, that's the way that they look at it. Like, this is harm to you. Say you're in a car accident and nothing happens to you. Well, they go, well, nothing happened to you, so you can't get any money. It's just the car. We'll repair your car, but you're fine. Nothing's going to happen to you. So that's what I think a lot of people don't understand, the process. They just think that you're going to sue and you're going to get a bunch of money. And I've had one lawsuit. I've tried to sue quite a few times, but it was one lawsuit. It took 6 years for me to get a payout of $12,000. And that, of course, $12,000 went right to my credit card. And I've forgotten about the pain and suffering. But that's what it all came down to, was pain and suffering. They looked at it like, you know, how much pain and suffering did you really have? You had pain and suffering at that time, but now it's all gone. And your dreams don't count for pain and suffering. So the next topic that I wanted to talk about, I don't know if I'm going to talk about a famous unmarked grave today or not. But what I always find interesting is the Wild West. And when I'm talking about the Wild West, basically the Mayflower cruises up. You've got all these wars going on the East Coast. You know, you got Spain, you got England, you got France. Everybody's jockeying for the new Americans, even though somebody already lives there, otherwise known as the Native Americans. And so then you've got people that are trying to get land, right? And then at one point the government is, you know, just like Tom Cruise's movie Far and Away, the government's like, hey, Homestead Act, go ahead and take as much land as you want. Just make sure you put up some flags and some markers with some sticks. That doesn't exist anymore, because they figured out we can tax people on their property and basically rob everybody blind. And the way I look at it is, we're going to look into nobody ever owning any property, because you don't own anything when you can get taxed. And if you don't pay your taxes, if you forget to pay $1 of your taxes, they can seize your home. Anyways, that's for another story. But so the Wild West, to me, is it's taking land. You're coming from the East Coast and it's going all the way over to California, and basically, Southern California, Northern California was San Francisco is where it all started, and then it went south. So that's why you had the gold rush started in Santa Clarita, but they don't talk about it because that used to be part of Mexico. I'm going to talk about that some other time. Also, the Mexican-American War ended right across the street from Universal Studios. Of course, Universal Studios was not there at the time. There's still an Adobe there where they signed the treaty, which I will get to in another thing. So you had all this stuff going on. Like, the history of Monterey is, you know, you had multiple countries, you had multiple people that were fighting all around that area, and that went down to basically people that owned land, rights to land, and it would be ranches. And so up the 5 freeway, you had Castaic, and you actually had the Castaic Range War, much like the movie Young Guns. I think Young Guns was in New Mexico. I had never heard of this before, so I wanted to talk about this with all of you. But it was the Castaic Range War, and also known as the Jenkins Charmical Affair. And it happened in Castaic, California, 1890 to 1916, between ranchers and farmers, William Jenkins and William Charmical. So both these guys are named Bill, who both staked claims on a piece of land in the territory. Now, think about that. You're living on your place, and this still goes on all the time. We just call it squatter's rights. But say you own a home, and say you, I don't know, go to the hospital, get sick, you're old, and you don't have any family, anybody watch over your home, and somebody just breaks into your home, and now they're living in your home, and they say, no, I have rights to this. Well, you're supposed to then be able to show proof, written proof. But back in the day, 100-something years ago, are you getting written proof? Are you getting enough written proof to say? Because somebody could easily come into town anywhere, you know, because nothing's cataloged on a computer. It's a written copy of, hey, this person has this land. It's my land grant, whatever. I think it'd be easily something to manipulate or forge or whatever you wanted to do to resell that land over and over again. So Charmical purchases 1,600 acres of the same land that Jenkins had already been on for a couple years. And, you know, Billy Charmical comes up to Billy Jenkins, is like, hey, I own this place now. So the land dispute couldn't be settled in the courts. Violence, of course, erupted because that's what people used to do. And I'm sure that they're still doing that now. It's just not over land. But then the two are like the Hatfields and McCoys. They're feuding with each other for over the next 20 years, with dozens of men from both sides killed. It was one of the largest range wars in American history and one of the bloodiest events in the state of California. William Jenkins, the rancher and gambler who staked a claim in the land of Castaic in 1875. So he's had that land for quite a while before Charmical shows up. During the Great Migration in the West following the Homestead Acts, I already talked about that. I nailed that, the Homestead Acts. I'm surprised I remember that. The late 19th century. So he's 16 when he moves from Ohio to Los Angeles with his family in 1851. In Castaic, Jenkins runs a successful ranch, an oil company, and a profitable cat business during the rat infestation. That's pretty amazing that you've got so many rats, which we already have so many rats anyways, depending on where you live. To have a cat company come out to get your rats. I'm wondering if they still do that. I doubt that they do. I'm sure they're using traps, but I like that. I like the cat company. I also like, a lot of people don't realize this, but Southern California is rich in oil, and there used to be oil fields. There are still oil fields around. There's oil fields that are in Santa Clarita area. But if you look at older pictures, if you go to the La Brea Tar Pits, you'll see pictures of oil derricks, rigs going all the way down to the beach as far as the eye can see. You still, I don't know if it's still active, but I know you had an oil rig on the Beverly Hills campus. I think maybe they got it taken down. But you kind of drive past them in Los Angeles, but there's a lot of oil and a lot of business going on with oil. There's also in Santa Clarita, there's still an old ghost town, which was an oil community for a very long time. And there's also in Newhall, there's still, I think the oil pump is still there. You can go and see it's a historical place now. But I would definitely do check that out because the oil town is pretty cool. It was called Mentryville. But anyways, Jenkins develops a reputation as a gambler, and a gunman, because you got to carry a gun around with you at that time. And at one time, Jenkins is deputized as a Los Angeles County Constable. In one incident, he's sent to go repossess a guitar from a local man named Antonio Ruiz. A fight breaks out during which Jenkins shoots and kills Ruiz. Jenkins is jailed and awaits a trial for murder. A mob of about 200 formed to lynch him. The sheriff was wounded during their failed attempt to swarm the jail, and Jenkins was later enlisted into the Los Angeles Rangers local militia, which is, I'm pretty sure, a predecessor of the LAPD. The group persuades the men who had shot the sheriff, arrested their leader, but later releases him. By 1872, Jenkins staked a claim near the Castaic Creek, building a ranch he called the Lazy J. I don't know where Castaic Creek is, but I am fascinated by creeks and rivers, and kind of a fascinating story. I don't know if I've talked about it, but was the San Francisco Dam, which burst, and it killed about 700 people, but it washed all the way down to out to Ventura, to the beach. And that was engineered by William Mulholland, and it ruined his career pretty much after that. In 1890, another rancher named William Charmichael settled nearby, claiming to have bought 1,600 acres of the exact same land that Jenkins had, and he said he bought it from the railroad. So you've got people that are showing up all the time. You've also got the government, which is trying to provide railroad crisscrossing the United States. And so that's going on all the time. And they're basically using an eminent domain, if it existed at the time, to take over. You know, hey, we're going to build a railroad right through your front door. No, you can't do that. And so there were a lot of legal fighting, but all those railroads went through, and they could care less where people's homes were. And they were also selling land at the time. This claim conflicted with that by Jenkins, and the two came to a conflict. The men failed to resolve them, of course, in court, and violence escalated. The same year, Jenkins sent three men onto the land that was disputed, and a friend of Charmichael's was shot at, or the friend fired on him and the intruders, killing two of them, while the third one escaped. Charmichael and Gardner surrendered to the sheriff, and a trial was set. They pleaded self-defense, saying they were protecting their own property. The trial lasted 18 days in June 1890, one of the longest trials in Los Angeles history. Jenkins was infuriated when they found Charmichael and Gardner not guilty. So, again, here's Jenkins. He's had this land for many, many years. Charmichael comes on the land with his friends. They get in a shootout, and the court finds this guy not guilty. Could pretty much happen today. The two men began to dispute mining, grazing, and water rights in addition to road building. So think about that. If you bought a property now, most likely in this area, the area of Santa Clarita, you're not going to have any sort of road building rights. You're not going to have water rights. You're not going to have mining rights. And you're not going to have grazing rights either. Those are four things that you could have made money if you had a property, which you no longer make money off of. I know in certain other areas that you can have all those other rights and stuff like that, but you certainly can't not have them. As far as I know, I don't have them on where I bought my house. A number of barns were burned on both sides, and men were killed in gun battles. In one incident, a young girl was killed in the crossfire. Later, Forest Ranger Robert Clark was appointed in 1905 by President Theodore Roosevelt, and he was sent out to end the feud. So this feud has been going on for a long time, and the President of the United States sends out a forest ranger to settle it, and that forest ranger does. That year, Jenkins is shot in the chest at the Lazy J home by a man working for Charmichael, but Jenkins survives. The feud continues after that shooting, and a group of men working for Jenkins burns down William Gardner's house, killing him and some members of his family. So Gardner is the one that went with Charmichael in the beginning to try to overtake Jenkins at his place, and he ends up dying. Charmichael retaliates by having his rival David Jenkins lynched in Bokeh Canyon. Bokeh Canyon is still there. There's still a little bit of a river and some waterfalls there, but no markers, anything like that, talking about how this feud went on. In 1913, Jenkins was shot while herding cattle off the disputed land by a man named William Rose, another Billy, who also claimed some of the land as Jenkins and who was an ally of Charmichael. Jenkins again survives another shooting, and the feud drew to a close. Rose pleads self-defense as Jenkins was a known gunfighter. Jenkins eventually died of an illness in 1916 while visiting relatives in Los Angeles. And you got to think about that. He probably doesn't have a car at this time. He's in his 80s. Probably takes you a good day to get down to downtown Los Angeles, which, I don't know, what's that, 40 miles or so? He's either 84 or 86, and he survived a total of 7 gunshot wounds during the Castaic Range Wars. Charmichael finally passes away in 1919, 3 years later, from kidney disease. In total, the Castaic Range War claimed the lives of 21 to 40 people. Much of the land dispute was at the intersection of Lake Hughes and Castaic Road, submerged under Castaic Lake now, behind Castaic Dam. In 1998, workers at a housing development, because now there's housing developments all around Castaic Lake, unearthed pine boxes containing the remains of an infant and 4 adult men. The site was believed to have been the site of the Jenkins family cemetery. So think about this. They're still, every time a development goes up, think about that land was owned by some rancher or something like that from a land grant, and there's no public places to take for a cemetery. You buried people on their land. So it's just like Poltergeist, where they've put up housing projects over cemeteries. So very interesting that they're able to dig it's a forgotten part of history, but they're able to dig them up. The site's believed to have been the site of the Jenkins family cemetery, and the bodies are believed to be some of the final victims of the Range War. Bokeh Canyon, where Jenkins' son was killed, has been nicknamed Hangman's Canyon or Dead Man's Canyon in reference to that hanging. Crazy, forgotten part of history for the Santa Clarita. Else you want me to see, and I appreciate everybody listening to Famous Graves Podcast.